Hello and welcome to The Gaggle, where we challenge and, if necessary, destroy media narratives. I'm George Samueli. With me today, of course, is co-founder of The Gaggle, Peter Lavelle, host also of RT's talk show, Crosstalk. Well, you know, Peter, every few years, we get these fake, phony Punch and Judy shows within NATO. Usually, some European power, namely France, expresses its dissatisfaction with NATO. It's never very clear what the thrust of the dissatisfaction, but usually it's like the child who's being ignored. So yeah, you may remember back
like in the seven-year itch, you know.
7-year itch, you know, back in the 60s, oh, the Americans are preoccupied with Vietnam, they're not interested in us. Then in the 70s, oh my God, America's going through a malaise, Watergate, and they're not interested in us. Then the 80s, oh, Americans are in Central America, and they're not interested in us. Then he was, oh, Americans are in the Persian Gulf, they're not interested in us. The Middle East, they're not interested in us.
And Trump.
And now, oh, they're preoccupied with China, they're not interested in us. So, and what does this all amount to? Well, it seems to amount to the French, usually the French, want to express some European dimension to NATO. They want something more European part of it. And this is the thrust of a lengthy interview given to Politico by the French defense minister, Madame Florence Parly. And she expressed a dissatisfaction. Strangely enough, she seemed dissatisfied that the United States was leaving Afghanistan without informing its European partners of its withdrawal. So, you know, you had to wonder. So the French plan is to stay on in Afghanistan, but leave that as it may. You kind of, as you read this article, you think, well, when is she going to actually give us this expression of this European dimension of NATO? And then she finally comes to it. Ah, the Sahel, Africa. Africa is where Europe is going to express its distinct identity within NATO. Now, you know, Africa has always played a strange role in the French imagination. If you remember, De Gaulle kind of had this grandiose ideas of creating this Francophone community of its former African colonies. And then his successor, President Giscard d'Estaing, who I have to say, Peter, I was very surprised to learn a few months ago was still alive on the day that he died. He died, and then I thought, wow, I didn't even know he was alive. But apparently, so that was when I found out that he all this time.
The French do that to you, you know.
But anyway, if you remember, Peter, back in the 70s, France was making all these strange interventions in Africa, which no one in the world understood what they were about. Chad and the Central African Republic, you know, they were doing this, again, part of the French imagination. So now, this Madame Florence Parly suggests that the French, and presumably its coalition of the European willing, will be intervening in the Sahel. Now, if you remember, why is there a crisis in Sahel? Well, it has something to do with the NATO intervention in Libya in 2011, which spilled over into Sahel. And so France is doing what NATO does best, addressing a problem that it was responsible for having created in the first place. All right, what was your take, Peter?
I mean, so the French want to use NATO as a neo-colonial project. Oh, well, great, fine, okay, great, okay. You're right. I mean, Africa's always played into the French imagination because they did pursue decolonization. That's part of the historical record. But De Gaulle, he was a smart fox, and he realized they can have their sovereignty as long as we control their banking system, okay? Manage all of their financials go through Paris. Oh, they can have all the sovereignty and independence they want, okay? This has been very much part of it here. And it continues, and it's really quite interesting as part of the French foreign policy DNA, because it doesn't really matter left, right, or center who's in power. There's always this urge, that tendency to go in that direction. It's a very bad habit, okay? It's a bad habit. And we saw what happened to Libya. And of course, it gives a reason for NATO to actually think about Africa because of a crisis they created in the first place, okay? But overall, it just that the Europeans just really don't know what to do with NATO, because if it weren't for the Baltic republics and countries like Poland, I think there would be very much a reassessment of what NATO is. But they have the Americans and the Atlanticists, they have a toehold there. And it always gets down to defense spending. And I always say this, you know, when I on Crosstalk over the years, when you have these pro-NATO people, and so I always ask this, the simple, obvious question is that, well, you don't want to pay more, but Russia is a threat. So if Russia was a threat, you would want to pay more. So you don't want to pay more because it's not a real threat. Is my logic sound? Everyone ties themselves up into a pretzel.
Right.
So, you know, and this is the real dilemma here. And the interesting thing with Britain leaving the European Union, they see themselves more as a bridge or an enforcer for the American interpretation of NATO. So they come in, they're kind of like, it's kind of like my dachshunds, you know? I mean, I take my dachshunds out and they do a lot of barking and they do a lot of posturing, but they don't do anything, okay? That's Britain, okay? Okay. So, but you know, it just shows that, it's really not just France and how it wants to use NATO. And the very fact that it's thinking about a mission for NATO is that if you've been listening to the gaggle, that's what we've been saying. They're searching for a mission for its existence. Now, I don't know if the Belgians and the Dutch and the Bulgarians are into the French gig into Africa. I tend to doubt it, okay? It will all very much depend on what the Americans want. And AFRICOM is big. That's a big gig for the Pentagon. Right. So and it's really interesting, just as a juxtaposition, I don't have the number of bases off the top of my head, but you know, juxtapose all of the bases that the US is establishing in the name of global security and NATO, and look at how many bridges and train tracks and factories the Chinese are building at the same time. Who do you think's gonna win out, George? Who do you think?
Well, that's right. But that's what's the amusing aspect of this interview, which is that she says, well, the Americans are getting themselves into a conflict with China, but that doesn't mean that we Europeans have to take sides in this. We're it's nothing to do with us. We'll just have our own separate identity. No, the whole point of NATO is that you subordinate your military and your foreign policy to the United States. That's it. The Americans aren't stupid. They're not going to just simply bankroll your your defense and your welfare state because they just love you having welfare and all the things that Americans themselves don't know. They do it because they expect you to support their foreign policy. And if you think that you're going to be able to stay out of this conflict with China, then you're nuts. Because already NATO is talking about expanding into Central Asia and into containing China. That's the NATO mission. It's this dual containment of China and Russia. So it's just complete fantasy that somehow, well, we'll still have NATO, but we'll have our own identity. No, there is only one NATO. NATO led by the United States. The orders come down from the boss. The boss is in the White House.
It seems to me this Madam Defense Minister has missed a few buffets in Brussels, okay? You know, I mean, what is she talking about?
Right.
But the very fact, and this is the most important point, the very fact that a senior member of the NATO alliance is talking to Politico in a major interview, talking about the future mission and how to define what NATO should be all about, is the most telling answer of all. If it's NATO, if it's North Africa, if it's Russia, China, but it begs the point, is that so you really don't know what the mission is, you want to change what it means. Because at the end of the day, it's Russia, anti-Russia stance is not enough to legitimize the existence of the alliance. And people know that. Look, we went through this COVID thing, the lockdowns, the economies are all scrambled up, and you still want to spend money on a mythical threat, really. And I think more and more, I mean, look, public opinion poll year after year after year, and this has been many years now, the majority of Germans want the Americans to leave their country. Because there's no reason for them to be there anymore.
Right.
Okay. And then you've been a loyal watcher of the gaggle. George and I have explained how they get around that. You have elite capture. of these defense ministries, intelligence community. Look what the Danes are as a conduit spying on the Germans. Okay, and so you really have this embedded elite capture. And you got to marvel at it. You really do, because I mean, Tony Blinken's on his democracy tour, but right. You know, this has nothing to do with democracy. Okay, right. It's about one thing: hegemony. And hegemony works when you follow orders, when you are the subordinate. It's clear, plain, a chain of command. I don't know what this woman's talking about.
Yeah, it is a chain of command. You know, right from the beginning, it always worked like this. The NATO, the supreme allied commander in Europe, who's the head of NATO, is an American. That's the key point. Yeah, Sakura is always an American. In other words, it is the Pentagon that sets policy. I mean, does anyone seriously believe that Hungary or the Czech Republic or Slovenia or Belgium, that any of them actually set policy? No. I mean, this has all been set by Washington. And there is no way that you can get yourself out of this unless you basically dissolve this alliance. I mean, it has been this fantasy that you can, we'll have this alliance going, but we'll have this European identity. You know, we just won't do what the Americans tell us to do.
It's like, you know, you have these eggs, these pillars, and then you scramble them up and they don't make any sense. It's all a blob, okay? It always ends up being that way. But, you know, I think it was over a year ago, it was before the pandemic, when Macron said NATO is brain dead.
Right.
And he's absolutely right. I mean, sometimes people are right for the wrong reasons. I don't know the context of what he said that. I do know he said it for a fact. But that is speaking the truth. And what really Europe should be worried about: terrorism, drugs, immigration. And you can use that to defend the entire bloc, and it would be money well spent.
Right.
Okay? Well, then you wouldn't have, you know, these two letters from, you know, current and retired military personnel in France writing about an impending civil war. If you dealt with terrorism, drugs, immigration, extremism, you wouldn't need those letters, okay? You have a military to take on all of these issues.
That's right, and that's, but those three things that you've just listed are all a consequence of NATO. I mean, you know, the terrorism, extremism, Islamism, all stem from these crazy interventions. Now, France played a key role in the attack on Libya. I mean, you know, that was, Obama played a role, certainly, but so did Sarkozy. So France played a big role in that, and that was an absolutely devastating. So the French, who have a very serious immigration problem, you know, I mean, everyone knew at the time, you remember what Gaddafi used to say to the Europeans, I'm the one who's basically saving you. I'm keeping these masses from invading your continent. And then they get rid of him. I mean, you know, and then the French think that they have somehow, well, we French, we understand these great power politics, you know, we understand power. You don't understand any power. I mean, this is the guy you needed to keep in power. So that's the same thing with, and France has been on board with Syria. I mean, at no point has France said, I think this is absolutely nuts, trying to get rid of Assad. He's a perfectly good leader of the country. He's not a Democrat, but he basically keeps that country together, and he's better than the alternative. No, at no point has any French leader said this.
And they actually should know better, George.
Right, exactly.
They should.
They were the colonial.
That's power. Right.
Yeah.
That's absolutely right. They should know better.
Right.
But, you know, what's interesting is we look on the horizon here. I've been looking at some of the data. The Green Party is stalling a little bit as we come up to the German elections. Maybe it's a blip. We're going to keep an eye on it. But we're going to, in the possibility of a Le Pen presidency, which is within the realm of possibility. So we're going to have some major fault lines moving, shaking in European politics, and when they can't agree on what what NATO is supposed to do. I mean, I personally think that, you know, it maybe the time has even passed, because, you know, do the Europeans have a Google? Do they have an Amazon? No. Okay, they just don't have they have the brains. I just, you know, they did. And of course, you know, the Americans are more than happy that everyone goes through their infrastructure, like Google, right, the financial system, and all of this. And, right, you know, and the Europeans have just you know, they basically defanged themselves to be able, I mean, I don't want them traipsing around Africa. They've helped the Africans enough over the last few centuries, okay? Enough help from the Europeans in Africa. But why don't they take care of their own people? Right. And actually what it would be is to look inward and to solve their own problems. Because all these times, you know, these people, you know, it's always switch and bait. You know, we have to fix this problem over, you know, we have to send some ships over there to Taiwan. Right. Why? Right. Why don't you protect your own borders from illegal immigrants? Okay, right. Well, that would be a great mission for your Navy.
Right. No, I think, but your point about, and I don't know the answer to this question, why don't the Europeans have their own Google, their own Facebook, their own Amazon? You know, I mean, why is it always dominated by the Americans? I mean, the Europeans, after all, they used to have their, you know, crack industries. You know, German industries were among the best in the world. Pharmaceuticals among the best in the world. The German cars are still among the best in the world. So how have they just been allowed themselves to be completely non-existent in this the age of...
You know why, George? You know why? I have a tentative answer to that, is because they fiddled with the European, European Economic Community, the EEC. That was the right track. And you would have gotten all of those things, okay? But no, they want political union. Right. They want these unicorns, you know? And it's ridiculous because nobody ever voted for it, ever. They don't know it. We don't know, okay? But these elites seem to know, okay? And plus the whole NATO scam, like I've said in the past videos, I mean, it's your CV, it's upward mobility, it's the professional managerial class. It's all the nonsense that doesn't help anybody in society other than this very small sliver of people. They control the media, okay, control the internet. So, you know, they're just, you know, these are unicorns jumping over rainbows, okay? And it's really pathetic because it's like, you know, you want to call the police about a burglar down the street, but your house is on fire.
Right. And of course, what's interesting is your point, which Trump kind of, you know, got himself, he blundered his way into, well, maybe he did better than blunder, but he kind of said, okay, well, if there is this great Russian threat that you're telling us about, hey, how about coughing up some more money for this? Which is a perfectly logical position, you know, okay, you know, put your money where your mouth is. Don't keep whining about these terrifying Russians. And in the meantime, you're signing all these deals for getting natural gas from the Russians and so on. But we're supposed to foot the bill for your welfare state. So he said this, and no wonder the Europeans were very unhappy. You know, we want to come back to the good old days. The Bidens, the Obamas, the Bushes. You know, who rhetorically they say, you must pay more for your military, but no one actually ever does anything about it.
Oh, they just go to the buffet, have a couple of wines and in the shower. Okay, yeah. I mean, they don't want to. They're trying to square the circle, and it's obviously you can't. Okay, and at the end of the day, there is going to be a shift here, and Europe should be prepared for it. I studied European history as a graduate school student, a PhD student. I have a great affection for Europe, but I see a bunch of boneheads running it, okay, into the ground,
right?
Okay, because of this ideology, and basically because of laziness. You know, if the Americans take care of it, they'll pay for it. They're dumb anyway. They don't respect the Americans at all, okay? And so, we got to spend more money on healthcare because these boneheads in America don't have it, but we have it, and it's expensive.
Very, very nice, exactly. But same goes with Israel, incidentally. The American fights Israel, but Israel has a very good healthcare system.
And basically free education as well.
Right, yeah, exactly. But it's interesting, I mean, what you're saying, because the Russians have absolutely no respect for the Europeans. I mean, the Russians may dislike the Americans, I mean, dislike Washington, but they do respect the United States. I mean, you know, whether it's Biden or Trump, or, you know, they still respect it. They have no respect for Europe. I mean, the way Lavrov talks about them with such scorn, this utter disdain for them, is just because, you know, they talk about this separate European identity, and then they are completely unable to realize it. They go running back to Uncle Sam, you know, or don't leave us, don't ignore us.
And essentially, I remember when Macron visited Trump basically humiliated his guest in front of the in front of the media, and Macron just kind of smiled and nodded his head. Okay, that's exactly the dynamic. Okay, but when Borrell comes to Moscow, the High Commissioner for Foreign Relations for the European Union, and he steps out of line, well, his toes, you know, he went back limping. Okay, that's good, because you're saying this is how we feel, and if you want to grow a backbone and have something interesting to say, then we'll have a conversation. Until then, go talk to Uncle Sam, and he'll soothe you, okay, and maybe sing you a lullaby. Okay, because the whole project is a lullaby. They're sleepwalking into disaster, and it's right in front of them. Okay, and you started out at the very beginning, every 7 year inch. Well, George and I have been around for a while. We've seen a lot of them.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. it's a regular thing, you know, the word whining from Europe, which never gets anywhere. We always go back to, it is like the child who suddenly starts whining, you know, why don't his parents pay enough attention to him? And then everything goes back to normal, you know, it goes back to...
The Europeans are like a 13-year-old girl begging for a new iPhone. That's it, in a nutshell. That's it.
And we can look forward to in this the summit that's coming up, when Monsieur Macron raises the issue of the NSA spying on Europe's leaders, and we can see that's going to be a very productive conversation.
Oh yeah, and Biden could say, "Huh, what was that?"
Nothing. I don't know anything about spying. Who's spying?
Spying among friends. What?
I'm going to look into it. I'm definitely going to look into it. Promise.
Just like I'm looking into the Durham report, okay? All right, I have an announcement for everybody. Over the next 2 days, tomorrow I'm going to St. Petersburg to the International Economic Forum there. I'll be there on Wednesday and Thursday. I'm coming back Thursday night. Now I'm bringing my trusty computer with me here. George and I are going to try to do some videos, but I got a really, really tight schedule. But I promise, if we can't accomplish anything, I promise a lot of pictures and some videos from the forum to show you who's there, who's not there, and if it was money well spent, okay? But I'm really looking forward to it. I'm doing 2 crosstalk recordings, and I'm moderating a panel. And it's going to be an interesting panel. It's about asset revaluation, hyperinflation, and how it's affecting the world order. So it could be kind of interesting. I look forward to it. So if there could be a hiatus in content over the next 2 days, don't worry about it. At the very, very least, on Friday, I'll be back in the saddle again.
All right,
Peter. And we're on Locals, thegaggle.locals.com.
Exactly, thegaggle.locals.com. Please support us to whatever extent you can. It helps us enormously. We're also on Rumble. Look us up there. And if you like The Gaggle, please like, share, and subscribe. See you soon. Bye.